Please be seated. To present David Hall, we're pleased to have with us David's longtime mentor, coach, best friend. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rich Berman.
Thank you, Chris. I can't tell you what a privilege and honor it is for me to be here today. I'd like to thank the Enshrinee Nomination Committee, Stan Smith, its chairman, and the other members today for their outstanding contributions to tennis. I meant to say the other inductees. I'm a little nervous. Please excuse me. I want to invite you to go back in time with me. It is 1994, an icy cold, snowy day in Boulder, Colorado. The door slowly opens to my tennis school. It's David Hall barely pushing his wheelchair through the door. He is shaking, his eyes are bloodshot, his face is covered in icicles, and he is visibly exhausted. No wonder. He has just pushed his chair 4 miles through the snow to train with me. This is David Hall, the quiet champion. In the 12 years that followed, I could tell you of many more stories of his unfailing dedication to tennis. But please indulge me as I tell you just one more. It is a few weeks before the 1996 Paralympics. We had been working nonstop. However, while working out at the gym, David injured his arm so badly, the orthopedic surgeon that we saw insisted he should withdraw from the 96 games, since his ruptured bicep tendon could be a career-ending injury. That night after dinner, I sheepishly looked at David and sadly said, "Well, mate, it looks like we're going to have to sit this one out." David stared intensely at me and said, "I'm playing. My mates are counting on me, and so is Tennis Australia." I still remember this like it was yesterday. So I learned to wrap his arm, and it was PT every day until the games. David had to change his style of play to be more aggressive so he could end points quickly. And yes, as you imagined, he won. Bronze in singles and a silver in doubles. So here I am. The luckiest of coaches, introducing my friend and hero to you and to the Hall of Fame. Many champions have been here and many more will come, but none with a bigger heart. None who played the game harder. None fairer or more noble. And I have to say that in addition to the three times I was told I was a father, this moment is my proudest. David Hall, my mentor, six-time world champion, gold medalist, eight-time US Open winner, devoted friend, wheelchair tennis ambassador, and I could go on and on. David, before I embarrass both of us anymore, come on up here. Ozzy, Ozzy, Ozzy.
Thank you. Thank you. This- Very kind. Thank you so much to Rich. I'm crying already. I remember the first time I picked up a tennis racket. I was 12 years old. Now here I am, 33 years later, and I'm being inducted into the International Tennis Hall of Fame. Could I ever have imagined on that day as a 12-year-old that I would be here today? Honestly, no. In my journey, I've felt so many different emotions. The emotion I feel today is grateful. Grateful that I've been given this incredible honor, and grateful that the people who helped me are here today to share in this moment. My mate Brownie was the first person I ever hit with. He was a fellow sports nut. We were at the tennis courts in Budgerywoy, a small coastal town in Australia. The year was 1982, and the big guns at the time were Mats Wilander and Ivan Lendl. They were winning slams. My favorite was Lendl because I liked his topspin backhand, and Brownie was a Mats fan for his hanging in there mentality and workmanlike game. We would run around the courts pretending we were playing Grand Slam finals, copying our heroes. I'd pretend to dry my racket with sawdust, just like Lendl, and Brownie would give me the Vic salute that Mats would do after he won a point. I remember those days like they were yesterday. They were so much fun that nothing outside that tennis court seemed to matter. We were free, laughing and carrying on. And that's where my love of tennis began. I had another beginning of sorts years later as a teenager. I thought the hitchhiking accident, which cost me my legs and almost my life, had robbed me of tennis. But I was wrong. After reading in a local newspaper about Terry Mason, a wheelchair tennis player, I was intrigued and hopeful. If this guy can play tennis from a wheelchair, well then maybe I can too. My first time on court with him seemed more challenging than fun. I was slow and hit the back fence more times than I can count, but it stoked something inside me which would drive me for years to come. Through those early days, after my accident, tennis was like a long-lost friend who would come back to me. Through all the turmoil my life had become, tennis was giving me comfort, something to look forward to. It was opening doors for me I never knew existed. It was sending me places I'd never been and giving me chances to meet people I would never have met. It was creating structure in a world that had none. As the wheelchair tennis tour took off, I knew deep down that I had to ride this wave. I had to at least give myself a chance to see where it could take me. I had to be all in. Tennis was giving me this opportunity, and if I didn't grasp it with everything I had, I didn't want to regret it later on. My first overseas tournament was the Japan Open, a wonderful mix of new experiences and old world charm. I saw the final of that tournament. Randy Snow and Laurent Giamartini were playing at a level that inspired me. The shots, the rallies, the drama, the crowd cheering. I wanted what they had. I wanted to be them. My first US Open at the Racquet Club of Irvine, the place where the history of the sport was unfolding before my very eyes. It gave me more inspiration, meeting Brad Parks, the founder of our sport. His words, his encouragement spurred me on. Tennis was giving me dreams that at the time seemed so far away, but yet a remote possibility. The dream to be number one, the dream to win the US Open, and the dream to win a gold medal for Australia. I moved to Boulder, Colorado, and although I didn't know it at the time, it turned out to be the best move I ever made. Maybe it was meant to be. Maybe it was meant to be, all written in the stars. Whatever it was, it changed the course of my life. I met Rich Berman. He was a tennis coach, but to me, he was much more than that. He was generous, he was kind, and he sacrificed so much to help me chase my dreams. He embraced me. and brought me into his home, made me feel welcome. The Bermans became my Boulder family. Lynn and our movie nights, wrestling on the floor with Laura, talking music with Brett, or basketball with Ryan, and Miss Ellie and her Lamington cake. I'll always cherish those moments. Rich would offer encouragement, advice, and do it all with a sense of humor that took a while to get used to. He would sing in the car on the way to practice, out of tune, I might add. I would teach him Australian slang like don't come the raw prawn with me and fair sucker the sav, which are phrases I barely understand. Rich would say, okay, it's time to do some pushing. So I pushed my chair to the end of Willow Creek Drive, the street where he lived, past the dog that wanted to go me. I'd reach the end of the street and I'd look over to the snow-capped Rocky Mountains and allow myself to dream what it would be like to win the US Open. Rich always knew the right thing to say as I'm waiting in the change rooms before the gold medal match at the Sydney Paralympics, the biggest match of my life. He said to me, no matter what happens out there, I'm proud of you. He changed the course of my career and changed my life, and for that, I'll be forever grateful. As we all know, behind every man is a better woman. For me, that was Leslie. I'll be the first to admit she is smarter and better looking than I. She rode the roller coaster with me through all the twists and the turns. She would be the first to kiss me after a win and console me after a loss. She would wish on a star in the night sky that I'd win that gold medal in Sydney and fill my tennis bag with good luck charms. I confided in her all my fears and doubts. I confided in her all my fears and doubts, and she supported me every step of the way. I would not be here without her. Tennis has given me more than I could ever repay. It took me in directions I never imagined. Tea with our Prime Minister, hitting balls with the Prince of Brunei, and meeting movie stars in Monaco. It took me to faraway lands, forging friendships, and experiencing different cultures. It gave me a purpose, a direction. It filled me up when I needed it and rewarded me with great joy when I worked for it. I never dreamed I could be as successful as I was, and when people recite my career stats, I still find it hard to comprehend. I had goals and worked as hard as I could to reach them. I don't think of myself as special or extraordinary. I'm just a kid from Budgieroy who loved to hit balls that was blessed to be surrounded by great people. Finally, to Mum, Dad, and Kristen, I'm lucky to have you, I love you, and I couldn't have done this without you. Congrats to Emily and Nancy, and thank you to the International Tennis Hall of Fame for this tremendous honor.
David, on behalf of the Board of Directors and the Executive Committee of the International Tennis Hall of Fame, please accept this certificate, which signifies your induction. on July 15th, 2015. Congratulations. Thank you. So Amelie, Nancy, and David, you've now received the highest honor in the game of tennis, in acknowledgement of these accomplishments both on and off the court. I'd like to ask each of you and each of our Hall of Famers to follow the class of 2015 in commemoration of their accomplishments for their victory lap around the center court, please.
Brett Haber back with you in Newport as the class of 2015 takes its ceremonial and traditional lap around the Bill Talbert Center Court here at the International Tennis Hall of Fame. A somewhat unusual induction ceremony in that the leading light of the class of 2015, Amelie Mauresmo, was unavailable because of her pregnancy, but she will walk with the class of 2016 next year still. Touching comments made by Hall of Fame President Stan Smith in her honor, and Marianne Bartoli, her countrywoman, in attendance to help honor Amelie. What a moving speech given by Aussie David Hall, the fourth wheelchair player inducted into the Hall of Fame. Lost his legs when he was struck by a car at the age of 16, went on to win 32 Grand Slam titles in wheelchair tennis. A tearful and moving acceptance speech by David Hall, introduced to the traditional Aussie, 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 and everyone responded with oi, oi, oi.